Okay, so I'm Kasper and this is Christian, and we're gonna be talking about cutting edge machine learning. Let's see if this works now. Seems to work. Okay, so what is machine learning or AI? So I found this on Twitter this morning. Elon Musk, this will be the best or the worst for the humanity. Quite a big quote, but I think it's also very hyped and extreme, a lot of buzz around the AI and machine learning at this point. It's more or less impossible to go to any kind of tech conference without this being one of the three biggest topics, no matter if it's websites or apps or backend. This is a big part of the agenda these days. It's also starting to be a much more, I would say, like accessible by non-Google-sized companies. There's a lot of tools out there, both SaaS products, but also like tools like TensorFlow or all the other ones, which are making it more accessible for smaller companies. You don't have to invest billions into this to actually see some results. That means it's also starting to hit regular size development projects as what Notice is working on. That's why we think it's super interesting for us to be part of this journey as well. I don't know how many of you have seen this one floating around on LinkedIn, especially the last couple of years, but this is a guide for what is a modern data scientist for companies out there to hire. And pretty much you, of course, they need to have the math and statistics skills to understand this topic, but they also need to have the domain knowledge and the soft skills to kind of to understand the business. They need programming and database skills and communication and visualization. And of course, this is fairly hard to find these types of people out there. There's also companies, especially in London, where we are working a lot, where they're hiring like 20 or 30 data scientists into Barclays or something like that. So it's a very bloated market at the moment, and very hard to find. There's a big difference in quality out there. You will see people who took an online course in Python calling themselves data scientists, and you will see PhD students in physics. So really big differences in here. So I think my advice here is if you are going to hire data scientists, be careful about what you do, because there's a big difference in quality. Let me see if I covered everything. Yeah. Another thing which I found hard as well when we were recruiting for data scientists is also like to see a track record of what they actually done, because most of them can tell about the theory. But they can't really show any like real life examples of where this was rolled out, and that's why it makes it a bit fluffy for everyone to understand what they actually do. So my experience, this is where we see most of the machine learning these days, is there's theory, and it's already pretty hard to get that into practice. Most are struggling just with this, but the real value is of course, this can bring value in coming back with a visualization dashboard or like a one-off extraction and showing some numbers to the C-level or the board or the department. But for me, the real value in machine learning is when you start bringing it to production. So that means you have a theory, you do the models, but you also get it all the way out in the business, in the production side of it. A good example in this is maybe 4-5 years ago, Notes were part of a startup, Grip, which is this networking application for professionals. And here, we built the startup here in Notes, and then we merged it with a UK company, which had three data scientists hired, and we thought that was super interesting. They could bring a lot of value in this product. I think we spent something like 5 man-days in Elasticsearch on making a really good algorithm. They spent 1.5 years on improving that. So that's also a good example of how much time it took for them to do something better than what Elasticsearch, which is a super powerful tool, can do. And I think the biggest error for them was that it was these PhDs in physics, and they were really good at showing things at their screens, and they could pull out data and do a lot of calculations and algorithms on it, but they never got it into production. It's just stayed on their local computers for 1.5 years until we decided to kind of, okay, we probably need less people working just in theory. We need more people who can actually get into production. And I hear this everywhere around, that this is where people are struggling in getting something out there. So So I think my recommendation is, if you're going to hire a data scientist, the programming and database part of it is a very, very big factor, because otherwise you will never see anything in production. You can also combine the team with having some people which understand this very deeply and maybe a little bit about machine learning, and having some which are really good at the machine learning and statistics, obviously, but everything needs to come together. Okay, so for notes, it's like we really wanted to have this capability, but we also wanted to do it in the way where we, which fits our DNA. So our DNA is very much to show something in production fast, get test something out and get it into production. And we also wanted to do the same thing with machine learning. We didn't want it to be like a 1 or 2 year project and maybe there will be some results. So I was interviewing a lot of data scientists both in London and in Copenhagen, and then I met these guys from Northbridge, and I could see that they actually was thinking the same thing. Try to keep it super simple. Figure out what do you want to solve, what part of data, what data you have to do it, but get something out there really fast in production, and then you can improve on afterwards. So that fits the DNA very well for Nodes, and that's why we teamed up with them as a specialist in the area, and we are more on the implementation side of it. But these guys also have a track record proving that they can actually put machine learning into production, make a pipeline where they can train models, test if they are better, roll them out in production. It's not like a manual task every time. I think I will give the word to you, Christian, yeah. So you can tell a little bit about yourself and cutting edge machine learning.
Okay, thank you. So I'm Christian, and I'm a partner at Northbridge with Sebastian, which is sitting in the audience. And there's been a lot of hype about AI, artificial intelligence, and you probably all heard about it. And some of the hype is well-founded, and a lot of the hype is like way off. And I'm trying to kind of dig down into the basic and tell you what is an AI system and how it does it work. I'm going to try to show you some nuts and bolts in this machinery. So at a high level view, AI is just a machine learning algorithm combined with some business logic. And business logic is just regular computer code, regular logic that says, if this, do that. And then the whole AI, the intelligence part, is in from this pattern recognition algorithm in machine learning. So what like 95%, 99% of AIs do, they have some fixed pattern in historical data, and they try to replicate it when they see new data. And then you have some business logic outside making sure that it doesn't do crazy stuff. That's 99% of production AIs, that's what they do. So just a brief overview of the latest cutting edge results within. So this is a result from January last year. It was Alibaba and Microsoft who made an algorithm that had human level comprehension. This is cutting edge. So it's a very famous data set made by Stanford. It's called Squad. It's small text snippets taken from Wikipedia. So there's a text. And there's a question. So here the question is, what is the second most abundant element? So the correct answer is helium. And there's a bulk of text, and then the algorithm needs to highlight the correct answer. So humans do this at a 82% success rate. So highlighting this. And the model they had is approximately the same, a little higher. And then there's been some debate, is it correct, is it not correct? But like this is the level of AI. Reading a piece of text. So this is a quite complicated task, actually. So by mass, oxygen is the third most abundant element in the universe after hydrogen and helium. So there's a lot of layers of knowledge to know that helium is the correct answer. First, you need to understand third most abundant. And then you need to understand that after hydrogen and helium. So you need to understand that oxygen is the third most, hydrogen is the second, and helium is the first. That's a quite difficult task, but they managed to do that. Another pretty awesome result was this Google Duplex presentation in May last year. I'm not sure if you've seen it, it's been all over the internet. It's a person calling a hairdresser's salon and making an appointment. And the big thing there is the whole voice generation algorithm, which is cutting edge. It has specific pauses. It can simulate human thinking and stuff like that. But it's mostly in the speech part that's cutting edge. You can, if you get the slides, you can click the link and you can see the presentation. Okay, so high level view. I said that AI is a combination of machine learning and business logic. So what is the machine learning part? Machine learning has a big overlap with classical statistics. Some people say that machine learning is just statistics. I would say that's taking it too far. Machine learning has a big overlap with statistics, especially classical machine learning. So it's also instructive to say what is not machine learning. So stuff like t-tests. If you had a classical course in statistics, you did tests on variables. That's not really part of machine learning. That's purely in the statistics department. Stuff that's purely in the machine learning department is deep learning algorithms, which I will talk about in the later slides. So just to tell you, machine learning is not that much different from statistics. It's not something completely new. It's basically statistics for the most part. Yeah.
I can try.
Yeah, please do. Okay, so one skip ahead, please. So yeah, so machine learning is dealt up in three main categories. There's supervised learning. This is where like 99% of all of the applications are, more or less. And then there's unsupervised learning, and there's this thing called reinforcement learning. So just to talk briefly about what is supervised learning. Supervised learning in this example is that you have some flowers, you measure two things, the petal length and the petal width. So you have two dimensions of the flower, and you try to classify it in two categories. There's this versicolor and virginica. And what the algorithm does, classical statistics, it fits a line that best separates this data. This algorithm comprises of two free parameters. There's two numbers you need to learn to solve this task. That's supervised machine learning. All other supervised machine learning is basically this concept. Then you have unsupervised machine learning. Unsupervised machine learning is machine learning where you don't know the correct answer beforehand. You only have data. You have lots and lots and lots and lots of variation, but you don't need really know what could be a grouping or what could be a response variable. So in this animation, this is a geyser that's shooting out of water, and it has a duration and a delay. So the delay between water shots and how long it lasts. So this is 6 minutes, this is 1 minute. And if you look at the data, like a human can see there's two groupings, that's pretty easy, but to get a machine learning algorithm to select the two grouping is actually pretty difficult, not that difficult, but it's a challenge. And that's what this algorithm does. It sees, okay, there's two distinct groupings, and then it iteratively finds the most likely groupings. Then we go into this field, the reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is the most AI-like of the fields. And that's where all the so-called self-learning happens. So a lot of the AI hype, you often hear that the algorithms are self-learning. And self-learning doesn't really happen in this part. All this, you have some data, it's fixed in time, and you just replicate the patterns you see. Over here, there's actually learning taking place. So this is the most basic example. It's an algorithm that's trying to learn to balance a pole. So here you say there's only one variable that it can vary across. It's the x-axis. So it's moving this rudder to try to get the pole up and balancing. And it's failing, it's failing, it's failing, it's failing. And the algorithm is measuring the angle here, and that's all. It's measuring the angle and the position of this. So it's two variables, basically. So now after, if you can go one slide ahead. Oh, it worked. Ah, then one back. Okay, so now we can see that it's after 236 trials, it's learned to balance the pole. And when the researcher comes in and is a bit annoying, tries to push it down, it catches the pole. Yeah, you have a question?
Sorry if I'm interrupting, but what about like self-driving cars? There is a big hype about it's AI, mm-hmm. but in my mind, I think that would be dangerous if they are making their own rules.
Mm-hmm.
So wouldn't that be supervised learning?
To be honest, I don't know all the bits and pieces of a self-driving car because I believe that it's a combination of many algorithms. I think they'll combine a lot of these techniques. So, but the AI part is just either way, it's some kind of a replication of a pattern. The big thing over here in the reinforcement part is that it's a feedback loop. So you when the algorithm places this x-axis, places this button part here, it actually affects the system, and the system reflects back on it. So when you have a feedback loop in a system like that, you need to have some reinforcement techniques. Over here, it's much more static. So I would experience that in the self-driving car, there's a big visual part of it. I would say that's over in the supervised thing. But I don't work at Google. I don't know the intricate parts of the self-driving car.
I must say at one point on the Tesla ones, 85% of this is rule-based. Yeah, so they contain the AI into very small bits and then rule-based around it.
Yeah.
Sounds it would be very dangerous, having cars getting smarter and smarter.
But mostly they won't, I think. So.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so now I'm just going to, in the three categories, I'm going to show you kind of what are the latest results or kind of the latest results in these fields. So, yeah. Okay. Yeah, okay. So let's just keep it here. So the first one, it's there's a very famous documentary on Netflix about this. It's Google DeepMind made an algorithm that could play Go at a superhuman level, actually. They can play world championship level, and I think it was last year, they made a new algorithm called AlphaZero, which is much lighter and only self-learning, self-taught. The original AlphaGo algorithm, it had a lot of human games that was transcribed, and it learned the patterns from there. But the new algorithm they did, it beat the old one. This is the learning curve, and this is number of days. No, actually, number of hours training, I think. And you can see up here the dotted line, that's the old AlphaGo algorithm, and after like 20 hours of training, it beats it. Oh, sorry, days, 21 days, it beats it. So this is kind of the real AI stuff. The rest over there is just pattern recognition. And down here we have Boston Dynamics, using more or less the same techniques that you saw on the pole balancing act. Now they can do it on a very high level, three-dimensional level, where you can get a robot to walk and jump stairs and do parkour and stuff. So next. In the unsupervised department, there's also some scary stuff going on. so this is NVIDIA from December 2018. So this top row is real faces. That's real people, real pictures. This row is also real faces, real people. What their algorithm can do is they can take two of these, this is called their style pictures, and this is the source, and then they generate these new persons. These people don't exist. They're only computer generated. So for example, this kid plus her equals him. That's scary. You should go to thispersondoesnotexist.com and you can see people generated like that. And what it actually does is that it takes these pictures are just pixels. Pixels is just three values, red, green, and blue. And it's just numbers. So it tries to replicate the distribution of these color values. And what it's been fed with is pictures of humans. And it can replicate the distribution of these numbers, these pixels, and generate these kind of scary pictures. The last one? Yeah, so and in the supervised department, this is from Google Brain. It was from August 2018. It's retina scanning. So it's the machine you have at your optician. It's called OCR scanning. You scan the picture of the eye, and it can recognize on a on par with humans, like defaults in the retina, clogs of blood and all kinds of stuff. And they're working with specialists in eye surgery with that. And they're doing pretty well. And there's a classical application of supervised learning. You have some pictures, you have some things, diagnosis you want to find out, and you try to match the two. So this one is some diagnosis, I don't know, some, I'm not a doctor. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so all of these applications I just showed you, they are based on neural networks. All of these three have neural, or four, have neural networks inside. And neural networks is just a mathematical model, and that's what is today called deep learning. So now I'm just gonna quickly explain what is deep learning, because that's been what's empowered all of these applications. So what is deep learning? Deep learning and AI has come more or less synonymous. So every time you hear something about AI, it's because the machine learning part of it is some deep learning algorithm. Deep learning is just a very flexible class of mathematical models. It's a class of model that has on the order of millions of parameters. The example you saw before with separating the two flowers, it had two parameters, two numbers I need to learn. These neural networks, they had on the order of millions, sometimes 100 millions of parameters. So you have a lot of degrees of freedom. You can learn very complicated patterns when you have millions and millions of numbers that to fit your problem. And deep learning has revolutionized machine learning. So it is true, the hype, some of the hype, but it has very much to do with revolutionizing machine learning. So the step going into a real artificial intelligence that is sentient, nowhere near that. But it has been had amazing impacts on machine learning. And I would say in more or less any field in machine learning tries to apply deep learning techniques nowadays. So this is just a brief overview. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but within image processing, speech processing, and natural language processing, that's where the biggest leaps have been from deep learning. For example, optical character recognition, that's on par with humans. Semantic modeling, that's the first slide we saw, like modeling the semantics of a text. That's also near human capabilities. There's some other stuff happening, but mainly it's the neural networks that kind of come into all these fields. So next slide, please. Okay, so how does, okay, I think I'm gonna press because there's a little animation here. So what is a neural network? So a neural network, some of you may have seen this diagram before, and I'm gonna try to explain what is this actually. So it's an input, X, it's a number, and the output in the end is also a number. So this is a very simple one-dimensional problem. And then I have two of these so-called hidden neurons. And what is a neuron? A neuron is just a function, a mathematical function, that takes an input and maps it to something that's between 0 and 1. So that's why it's called a neuron. It's like it fires or it doesn't fire. So we have just, and Y is just a combination of those two. So don't worry, I'm not going to go through a whole math lecture here, but it's just, so what you see here is a weight multiplied by the first neuron, plus another weight multiplied by the second neuron, plus some constant. So I'm taking a weighted average of the two neurons to produce my output Y. That's it. That is a neural network. And you just replicate this. So instead of having two, you will have millions and millions of neurons. And then you can replicate more and more rich variation. So let's say we have some function. A function is just a relationship between an X and a Y variable, and we would like to approximate it with a neural network. So what do we do? So we have the two neuron outputs. You can see the gray one has been flipped, and that just means that this one has been negative, so we are just flipping it. So with this, we try to replicate the original one, so the pink curve here is the sum of the two neuron outputs, or as I said before, a weighted average. And this becomes a pretty good approximation of the original function. And that's what neural networks do. And these functions could be anything. It could be pictures, it could be Go games, it could be anything. It's just approximating a function. And I'm not sure, where are we on time? Are we, it's fine? Okay, okay. So I'll just show you briefly an animation of how, what does it look like when a neural network is trained. So this is TensorFlow. They've made this website. TensorFlow is an open source library. So this is kind of a playground. So here we have, not before we only had one input. Now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 inputs. Or yeah, six, yeah, it doesn't matter, six inputs. And what we try to replicate is a kind of, in a mathematical term, complicated function. It's two spirals. So there's the yellow spiral and the blue spiral. So it's not a linear function for sure. It's something that's a bit more complicated than a linear function. And now what we're going to try to do is classify the two groups of points only knowing their xy coordinate. So we don't know anything about the relationship. We just know where they're placed in this 2D space. And we have made a deep network because it has multiple layers of neurons. So we have six neurons here, four here, four here, and two here. So it's a four-layer network, and we're going to try to match this. So let's see how it goes. So what you see, the green and blue zones here, is the best prediction at the given time. And this is number of steps in the learning algorithm. So it's just trying to replicate the pattern. And you can see now it's getting the center of the spiral here, but outside here, I haven't learned it yet, but it's getting closer. It's getting closer. This is a little random each time you run it, so I'm not sure when it's gonna learn completely, but I'm gonna stop it at some point. Okay, so this is a good time. Yeah, okay, so there's a good point to come across here. So first of all, we can see that each of these neurons has learned different aspects of the problem. So this neuron had learned something about not yellow over here, and this neuron has learned something about not yellow here, not yellow here, and the final output is this. And what would happen if I got a new yellow dot down here? It would be classified as blue, because it's never seen anything in this region. If I got a blue dot up here, it would be classified as yellow. So this is also a good teaching that all these algorithms are only as good as the data. They can never extrapolate outside of the realm of the data. They can generalize pretty well within the range, but outside it doesn't know what's going on. So out here would make very bad predictions, and down here as well, because a human, we can see, okay, the spiral would continue this way. But the algorithm will say, no, it's just blue. Yeah.
We have time for some questions in the end. 5 minutes, 6 minutes left.
Okay, so okay, I'll just, so yeah, for sure. So I just have two examples that I will, so this is just, okay, now we've been up here. So I'm just want to show you two examples of how we've been doing stuff in practice. So when you want to do a proof of concept, you don't want to do deep neural stuff. Maybe you just want to do something very simple. And that's the best approach in our experience, to do something very, very simple. So this is a pilot we did. So the task was to find the edges of this t-shirt. And we used some kind of old techniques from a paper from 1995 from Coates and Taylor. And we had very good results. This is another application, also some very old stuff from 2001. It was, we had a database of description of products, and they had a small text of, let's say, 100, 200 words, and we wanted to extract keywords from it so we could improve search results. So we trained what's called a conditional random field model to extract these keywords, and it also worked quite well. And that's a very old school technique from 2001. but a simple application. And this is all the technologies that makes it happen. Yeah, let's not go into too much detail. So questions?
Any questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How does doing the traditional training of your model differ from self-learning algorithms?
So in a fundamental way, there's no real difference. The only real difference is that it's a repetitive task. So the technique you use in classical is stuff like called gradient descent. Gradient descent is, say you have a hill and you want to find the minimum on that hill. And I'm standing on the hill and I can feel with my feet, oh, the hill is pointing in that direction. Then I take one step this way. And then at some point in time, I would be at the bottom of the hill. Translate that into mathematics. And reinforcement learning, just do that in a recursive fashion, plus some magic. but they do that in a recursive fashion. There's no magic, actually. It's a recursive way of just doing gradient descent. So more or less the same. Any other questions? Yeah.
Great presentation, by the way. But
thank you.
If I'm going home now and trying to convey this message to executives,
yeah,
I will be thrown out in 30 seconds.
Yeah.
What is your recommendation in trying to convey these things in a simple way so they understand the power of this?
Yeah.
Can you put some words on that?
So I would start with first asking them, do they have a pain that they could identify in their organization, some kind of pain? And then I would try to match that pain with a machine learning or with a solution, first of all, and see if machine learning could be applied to that.
Some kind of exemplified, like the T-shirt.
Yeah, the T-shirts, stuff like, yeah, so simple examples, really, like the
Pixiebook.
Yeah, Pixiebook exam. So, for example, the T-shirt example is quite simple. Everybody can understand it, and yeah.
You need to make some beautiful visualizations and use small cute icons. So when you were saying Pixiebook, that works. Mm. That's like my experience, because like the CEOs are good at some stuff, and then they're not that good at other things. So you need to like show some awesome difficult data visualizations, and it also like relates to what Casper just talked about, the data sciences. That's not like, I don't think. One, yeah, there exists some data scientists, I've met a lot of them, but they're not like that, they are visual, but they don't perhaps have like design skills, like illustrator skills. So I think you can like take the data sciences and break them up in like some groups, because a data visualizer doesn't need to have like deep knowledge about statistics. I visualize a lot of data, and I don't want to make like statistics at all. It's like there's somebody good or better at that. So I think, yeah, try to think it like in groups of skills and then combine them in a team, because it's quite a lot to ask for a person to both communicate with data and code and blah, blah, blah.
So if the C-suite asks you, why should we invest in machine learning, I would say, machine learning is great for automating tasks that humans are maybe good at and we couldn't do before with machines. So 100 years ago we had the Industrial Revolution. Now we're having like the second Industrial Revolution, where we can automate a lot of cognitive tasks, like recognizing things in a picture or recognizing pieces in text. It has to be very narrow, very well specified, but if you previously had a team of 100 people doing something very basic, but you needed 100 people because you had so many tasks to do, that you can now automate basically. That's kind of the current best value of it, I would say.
But in the end of our presentation, we will go through how to get started, because we have been working on a couple of projects together with Northbridge and trying to do what you were asking for.
I have one question for you, Casper. The timeline in this, how much time are we talking about? You touched upon GRID, and then I've seen this Google DeepMind working with the Breakout, the old Atari game where you see the bottom bar moving and shooting up the pinball, and I think the thing is that around try number 200, it's completely, it's still like learning to crawl. And then around try 300, it's actually learning to go around, you know, the boxes and that,
yeah,
that strategy that it learns on its own.
For sure.
To be on top of that. I don't know if that makes sense to you. Yeah,
so. Yeah, so
it's so fast though.
Yeah, it's quite fast. Like, but all the reinforcement learning stuff, that's basically really difficult tasks for a computer. All these supervised tasks, which is 99% of the applications, that's like lightning fast to train. It takes on the order of seconds to train. This, but making the whole code, I would say this project, Seb, was that on a, like 100 hour or less? How long?
Much?
Oh, 60 hours. So this, for example, is a 60-hour project. So that's a very good starting point. The same with the keyword extractor is on that order timescale. So, but if, of course, if you want to do really advanced stuff, the training of the algorithms, it comes into play. But for most applications, you can do it with simple algorithms that train in order of seconds.
But also, I think a note to that is it's because you have experience and know this model would probably work for that.
For sure.
If you started like I started, where I have coded for many years, then it's a lot of trial and error. Like, okay, try this model, does it work? Follow a new tutorial. Like,
Then
it can be very time consuming. But of course, these guys have done this for several years, and when they see a problem like this, they know, okay, it's going to be one of these two or three models, so they already cut 90-95% of the options. That helps a lot.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, thank you so much
You're welcome.
For that.
Thank you.